Good afternoon. Welcome to Arts, Culture, and Thing in Between. I'm your host, Rose October, and I thank you for spending your Valentine's Day with me. Happy Valentine's Day to all of you people out there, those of you who are sitting with us right now, and those of you who will be listening to the recording later on, because you are truly celebrating your Valentine's Day. So, as usual, I tell you a little bit about the program, and today is no exception. The program Arts, Culture, and Thing in Between is one that features individuals who are gatekeepers of our arts and culture. They're not only performing artists, but also teachers, advocates, and scholars who focus on the preservation of the arts and culture. When arts is mentioned, it is being referred to as different art forms, like visual, applied, or performing arts. Examples of visual arts are painting, sculpting, and filming. Examples of applied arts are architecture, as in designing and building up or constructing a project. Fashion designing is applied arts. The way that the fashion designer works with different patterns and fabrics. Jewelry designing is applied arts. The way that the jewelry designer works with materials such as wood, plastic, metal, silver, gold, and stones. Furniture designing is also applied arts. The way that the furniture designer works with various types of woods, the ways that the woods are layered, cut, and designed. Then there is performing arts. Examples of performing arts are music, theater, opera, drama, singing, stand-up comedy, and dance. The middle part of the name of the program is Culture, Arts, Culture, and Thing in Between. Let me tell you about culture. When culture is mentioned, it generally means the ways of life for a particular group of people. So for this program, it is inclusive to mean the various groups of individuals that embrace ways of life. In other words, looking at attitudes and behaviors. What is important to note is that as culture is mentioned, I'm really looking at how practices are passed from one generation to another. Thing in Between, the last part of the name of the program. This has to do with life's issues that affect the execution of the arts and cultural practices. This involves both positive and negative experiences that become part of the creative process. Today's guest has a little bit of all, plus some in between. Let me share the bio. Onika Blaze, fondly called Nick, is a public health advisor, certified life coach, entrepreneur, community servant, pageant queen, and pageant executive. She was born in Guyana and as a toddler was brought to the United States by her mother, Wendy Williams. She was raised in Brooklyn, New York, where she was educated at PS 41, an elementary school, junior high school 241, and the Academy of the Arts, a high school. Upon completion of high school, she attended Long Island University, the Brooklyn campus, where she earned a bachelor's degree in psychology. Following graduation, she worked as a flight attendant for American Airlines, where she stayed for 3 years until 2001. In the same year, 2001, Nick began working at an ophthalmologist's office, where she spent 2 years before relocating to Miami, Florida. Once in Florida, she worked with Royal Caribbean Cruise Line until her employment was shortened because of an automobile accident. later, in 2006, Nick moved from Miami, Florida to Atlanta, Georgia, and secured a position as a contracted program analyst at Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. After 2 years in this position, she gained full-time employment as a management and program analyst, a position she held for 4 years. She then was offered the current position of public health advisor, where she serves as the principal project officer, supporting emergency preparedness and managing a budget of over $190 million. Nick is an entrepreneur. In 2008, she and her mother began a cosmetic company, Nick B Cosmetics, for which she is also the spokesperson. This Atlanta-based company specializes in beauty products made for women of diverse races and ethnicities. She's also the co-owner of Inspire Gravity Consulting, a company with three different arms of services that cater to fitness and pageant competitions, life coaching, and trucking, as in transportation. As she navigated life, in 2011, she earned a master's degree in social and behavioral sciences from Ashford University in Iowa. In 2012, Nick became a certified life coach that allows her to provide services to individual, couples, and corporations. Her coaching of individuals and couples involves making assessments of temperament while assisting with personal navigation of self-discovery. On the other hand, in working with corporations, she offers team building trainings to enhance the development of staff members while coaching on how to maximize members' strengths and talents. In 2013, Nick founded Dorothy's House. This institution is based on working with youth who age out of the foster care system in Atlanta. Currently, this institution is a trailblazer for its mentor matching program, where high-level executives are paired with youth who have aged out of the foster care system. This institution is supported by companies such as Bank of America, Arena Delta, Coca-Cola, Southern Plastic Surgery, Caribbean Shipping, and Aldi's. It is noteworthy that Dorothy's House engages in international work that spans Trinidad and Guyana. They are targeted fundraising for specific and necessary items that are shipped to Carnarvon in Trinidad and Georgetown in Guyana. These items are distributed to various organizations that cater to the youth. Nick is also in the business of pageantry. In 2018, she became an executive director in the world of pageantry. Her pageant experience began at the age of 9 when she attended PS 41. In this pageant, she emerged the winner, and this laid the foundation for many pageants to come. The next pageant she entered was the Al Jackson Talented Teens at 15 years old, where she won the place of fourth runner-up of over 100 delegates. At 17 years old, she was a delegate and was crowned the queen in the Miss Guyana New York pageant spearheaded by Negla Brandis. At 19 years old, she entered the Miss Caribbean International pageant, which she also emerged the winner, the queen. Following this, she took an 18-year hiatus, within which time she became a spouse and mother. And in 2015, she entered the Mrs. Georgia America, a pageant where she won the place of the second runner-up. In 2016, the following year, she returned with persistence to win the Mrs. Georgia America and was crowned the queen. This reign allowed her the opportunity to represent Georgia at the Mrs. America, where she placed in the top five of 52 women. In 2018, Nick's expansive experiences in pageants were foundational for becoming a pageant executive. She bought the pageant franchise for the Miss Earth USA, a franchise she still holds today that covers four states, Alabama, Georgia, Florida, and Tennessee. Currently, her Georgia pageant has been recognized as the third best for pageantry in the United States. With over 20 years of pageant experience, her passion for pageantry is exemplified during each session she conducts, where she brings a wealth of experience. She coaches contestants of all ages and experience levels. As a community servant, Nick has been recognized for her community service. To her credit, as the winner of the pageant, Mrs. Georgia America, she has received two commendations from the governor of Georgia for all the community work she had done that year. In addition, she's the recipient of several awards for exemplary service in public health for her continued role in emergency preparedness. She has also been honored by the governor's office and City Hall of Georgia with proclamations and citations for her dedicated work to children in the foster care system. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, before I welcome our guest, Onika Blaze, fondly called Nick, to the program today, let's take a little peek of who she is. Nick, I have to get accustomed to calling you Nick, because when we met 20 odd years ago, 25 years ago, you were Onika to me. So things happened in the meantime. I understand. I've aged out, you know. Welcome. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me today. I'm excited to chat with you today.
Yeah, I'm glad. I'm excited to chat with you. It's been eons. So you looked at those pictures, especially the younger ones, and you're thinking, what?
Yeah, I was like, where did she get some of these pictures from? Because some of them definitely brought back memories, especially some of the older pageant pictures. I haven't seen them in years.
And I was laughing at some of them, I must confess. Look how far we've come, you know.
So
let's chat a little bit about your beginnings. You came to this country when you were a toddler. You didn't even know that you were coming. You
brought
here, right? Because you were a baby, Wendy Williams, and you received your education in Brooklyn. As a matter of fact, you attended a specialty high school, right? For the arts, the academy.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. How was that for you?
It was very different. It was a different time. It's funny because my same high school, my husband, his dad actually attended that high school years before with Barbara Streisand. So it definitely had a great history, but with most schools at the time in Brooklyn, it started to decline. So the arts was something that you had to really, really pursue. So I did dance, a lot of modern dancing while I was there. And I was also a cheerleader. I was a cheerleading captain in high school, but it definitely has changed, and it's since broken now into about 5 different schools now. There are different arts, and now they're more focused on art, dance, acting, and that kind of stuff. So it's definitely grown since I've attended there.
So you did modern dance and what else? Cheerleading?
I did cheerleading, yes, yes.
Cheerleading is a variation on a theme when you look at dance and movement.
Yeah, yeah. Right. Burn off all my energy.
No, I am thinking that, and I don't know here, so you'll have to correct me, guide me, teach me. Hearing that a school is academy, mm-hmm. you know, the arts, you're thinking the students will eat, breathe, and sleep the arts. Mm-hmm. And I hear how you describe your experience, and it seems as though dancing was in passing and cheerleading was in passing. Am I correct?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. And I think that's probably why, even to this day, I'm so gravitated. I gravitate towards the arts because I did feel like there was something missing. The little that I had in high school, it was me going after it. And then also doing things outside of high school to keep going with the arts, because I thought it was very, very important. And I still think it's important today, but it was very different. It was not, it wasn't like you see in the movies, whereas, you know, math and science came secondary and arts and culture was first. It definitely was not that. But it did enough, and there were influential teachers. And I had several teachers. I mean, one of my teachers, Miss Lucas, I remember her name to this day because she was very impactful to me towards pursuing arts and crafts. So definitely it could have been more, but you know, that's as they say, you know, these are the things in between, right?
Yeah. Let me tell you, once you shout out, you know, teachers, as far as I'm concerned, the program is over. I just love paying homage to teachers because they do such an awesome job that sometimes parents don't even realize the depth of the work and the impact.
Yeah, definitely the impact is so great.
Children's life. And shout out to Teacher Stella, and shout out to Big Daphne Rogers, my loves, you're my Valentine today.
Yes. So,
you know, you know, those are two women in my life who are responsible for my career in theater, I would say.
Definitely.
Specifically dance, but you know, I got my humble beginnings in theater with dance, and other things came on top. So what did you do outside of school then? Because if it was not enough, and you had the passion for the arts, what were you doing after school, if anything, or outside of the school? Dance?
Dance. My mom had me enrolled in ballet. She had me enrolled in tap. She had me enrolled in modern dancing. So what I was not getting in school, I was doing outside of school. And what that meant was I didn't really have time to hang out with my friends. All about me pursuing something in the arts. So I was always busy dancing. She had me modeling. She had me doing pageants. And it was just never any time other than doing extracurricular activities.
Mommy was smart.
Definitely. Definitely paid off for sure.
Oh my gosh. So aside from your involvement in the pageants, which we will chat about later, what did you want to become when you grew up?
I wanted to be, at first, a lawyer, because everyone always said in my family, you ask a lot of questions, you talk. So my family told me you should become a lawyer. But when I was in high school, I saw this movie called Outbreak. And watching that movie, I wanted to be an epidemiologist just because I saw what they did and how they worked with diseases and how they helped humanity. And that's what I wanted to do. And even in my high school yearbook, I have teachers that in my yearbook signed it saying, good luck if you ever get a chance to work at the CDC. And it's just, you know, it's something that's far-fetched. You're in high school, you know, you're graduating high school, not really thinking about it. And that's really the road that led me to where I am today. But definitely, I wanted to pursue something in the sciences, for sure.
Now, who influenced you as a child?
My mother and my grandmother. Both of, like I always tell people, I never was the kid that got spanked, you know, as a kid growing up. And not to say that, you know, there's anything against disciplining, but my mom and my grandmother, they just led a tight ship at home. And I didn't venture into certain lanes because they just were very strict. And it sometimes not until you're an adult, you realize that strictness leads a foundation. It paves a way for you to have discipline, for you to want more, and for you to always be ambitious. And they definitely influenced me to be the woman I am today based on how they raised me.
Love it, love it, love it. It's so funny because, oh man, I can't believe I'll confess this. You know, I grew up with strict parents too. And it's a long life. It's a long list of us. They once was 16, right? There are 10 of us alive right now. And I'm the last girl and I have a brother who's behind me, right? So I'm the second to last child. And we would get away to go and party. And we would pretty much get spanked, you know, if we were caught, when we were caught. And there were chores that we had to do every day, regardless, you know, there was a system, there was a job schedule for us, put it that way, because my family owned the business too. But the funny thing is, I remember as a teenager, my brother and I, we were plotting about how to hurt my father. Because he was so strict. I tell you, as children, I look back and we can laugh at this right now, I wouldn't have it any other way. I really wouldn't have it any other way. I mean, we had some really mean thoughts for my dad. Not that we could have operationalized the plan. There is no way, you know, but we were just, you know, just venting. Anyways, so what is your best childhood memory?
Oh, I would definitely say every time I had an opportunity every summer to go back to Guyana, I never realized how much fun you can have when the only thing you thought about was, I can't wait to wake up in the morning to climb a mango tree, to get a mango, or to just literally just the freedom of just running around without worrying. I realized my childhood was carefree. Mm-hmm. It was worry-free and it was carefree. And that's what I remember fondly.
Oh, gosh. Now, what is your worst childhood memory?
I would definitely say my worst childhood memory was when my Uncle Brian passed away. I always looked at my mom as this strong disciplinary that just didn't smile often because she was always busy working. And when my Uncle Brian died, that was the first time I saw my mom cry. And that's when you realize that, you know, you look back, you realize that she's human, you know? But seeing the pain it caused her losing her brother, that was definitely one of the worst memories I had as a child.
Now, based on that, were you ever thinking that you have to be strong all the time, you know, you have to be outstanding and upstanding, and then you saw your mom cry and things shifted? How was that for you?
I think, you know, growing up, you know, in the time, it was, you know, we were not the huggy, touchy, feely, you know, I love you, let me hug you all the time. It was, you study books, not boys, you do this, you do that, you go the straight and narrow. And that, I think that was the first time I realized that emotion is something that everyone possesses. Some people just hide it better.
Yeah.
And I learned that there are times that you should hide your emotions, but it's also okay to be vulnerable too.
Yeah. So let's take a peek of some more of you. How about that?
Sure.
Just saw some faces of you there.
Many faces.
Yes. So for those of you who are joining us now or who joined us after we started today, I'm sitting with Nick, who is a public health advisor, certified life coach, entrepreneur, community servant, pageant queen, and pageant executive. Thank you for joining us. Now, let's fast forward here. Nick, your bachelor degree from Long Island University, Brooklyn campus,
yes,
is in psychology.
Yes.
What prompted you to get a degree in psychology? I know that as a child, you wanted to become an, what was it?
Epidemiologist.
Epidemiologist, right. You wanted to become an epidemiologist, but you went psychology. How is psychology going to get you to epidemiology? Tell me.
You know, it's one of those things that as you go through life and you start your journey, the road kind of winds differently. And I started right out of high school, I just started to be fascinated with how people think, but mostly why people do the things they do and how we make people feel. And even to this day, I'm always concerned with what people are not saying. And psychology was an opportunity for me to really figure out what makes people tick and also discover things about myself too. And I thought that that would be a good avenue. Didn't think I was going to become a therapist or a psychologist. It was just something I was very, very fascinated by, and I'm still fascinated by it today. But that's where that road took me.
Okay. You know, I'm glad to hear you say, well, you know, I really didn't want to become a therapist.
Yeah.
So many students, and I'm putting on my academic hat here, many students want to take an undergraduate degree in psychology, and they figure that is going to make them become a psychologist.
Right.
You know? And when they hear, like, you can't, you know, maybe if you go for your master's degree, that's when you really start to scratch the surface in terms of employability and being recognized as somebody in psychology. But until you get a PhD in psychology, I mean, I know it's a damper when I tell them, but let me tell you, quick, fast, they regroup. Yeah. They regroup and come again. So I'm glad to hear that you're saying that when you did it, it was for those reasons.
Yeah.
But after you got your degree, though, in psychology, you became a flight attendant. Mm-hmm. Make the connection. How did that happen? Tell us.
So while I was in school, I had a part-time job at Macy's. So nothing, you know, just to kind of help pay for things with school and stuff. And one day this lady said to me, she's like, hey, you know, I love your personality. Have you ever thought about being a flight attendant? I'm like, no, not really, no. And she said, you should think about it. And, you know, you fast forward and I bump into this lady again a few years later. And she's like, I remember you. You worked at Macy's. She said, you know, I'm telling you, you should really consider it. She said, as a matter of fact, I am the hiring director at LaGuardia Airport. And she said, you know, here's my card. You know, give me a call. I would love to just meet with you and just kind of talk to you a little bit. And called her, and you fast forward, went through 6 weeks of training in Texas and became a flight attendant. And it was
lucky girl, you. Look at that.
It was a great experience. And it's funny because it also had a component of health and safety to it. So it seemed like everything I did is led me to where I am right now when it comes to public health. Mm-hmm. Because even as a flight attendant, you still had to follow certain rules and regulations, certain health codes, and certain safety precautions. And they're all things that are impacting what I do professionally today. So
wow.
It's all tied.
Yeah, but you know what? Our past experiences are who we are today.
Yeah, definitely.
Take those experiences off along the way and say, this is who I am now, and forget those. You cannot.
Definitely. I still think to this day, my husband will tell you, I fold clothes really well because of the time I spent working at Macy's. I can fold a t-shirt really well, even the sheets that most people, the fitted sheets. So everything, you know, even the smallest thing that you do, the things that are just stepping stones to your next adventure or your next place you're going to land, it's going to shape you. And you just have to know what to take and what to leave behind. So. Yeah.
So let me tell you what I'm taking. Next time you're in New York, let me know. So I leave my bundle out after I've walked.
Yes. Bring it on. Definitely bring it on.
Oh my gosh. So you left American Airlines and went into an ophthalmologist's office. Yes. Tell us about that shift.
So, you know, my daughter was pretty young at the time, and I just decided I was tired of flying. I was tired of just, you know, going back and forth. And at a time when I flew for American, they had what's known effectively in the industry as senior mamas. And those are the ladies who got all the great trips because they've been with the company for so many years. So I just, you know, I was just tired of some of the crappy trips, and I just wanted something different. So I decided, you know, I'm just going to take a break, spend some time with my daughter, and just, you know, relax a little bit. And one day, this is going to sound strange, but one day I was calling a doctor's office to schedule an appointment, and I called the wrong phone number. And the lady who answered was the office manager for the eye doctor office. And she's like, no, sorry, you have the wrong number. It's like, oh, sorry. Call back a second time, happened again. The third time, I was like, okay, where are you located? Because I'm trying to find a doctor's office. And she's just, you know, talking. She's like, oh, no, this is the wrong number. We've had this number for several years, back and forth going. And she's like, you know, I like your voice. She's like, you have a very nice voice. You know, have you ever thought of doing receptionist work? We're looking for a receptionist right now. And I'm like, no, I never thought of being a receptionist, you know. She said, well, what do you do? I said, I used to be a flight attendant. I said, you know, but sales is more my thing than being a receptionist. I don't want to be stuck back office answering phones. She's like, hey, why don't you come down and see the practice? So wasn't working. So I went down there and ended up working there. You know, she did like an impromptu interview. And before I knew it, I was working. Doctor's office.
Stories, I must say.
And made some of my best friends from working there.
Wow. Nice. I want to go back a bit though. Mm-hmm. You talked about the mama what?
The senior mamas.
You know. So you weren't able to really bid, so to speak. I know the pilots bid. I don't know what flight attendants do, if they call it bidding too. Mm-hmm. But you were not able to get lines that you would have loved.
Right. You can bid, but you're bidding and you're not getting anything you bid for.
Right. You just have to settle.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
You know, in settling though, were you able to go to countries that you enjoyed?
No. Wow. Absolutely not. I think the best trips were the California trips, because we were there, you get to stay there for about 3 days. So you get to hit the beach and you get to kind of, you know, do a little shopping, sightseeing. But that was the extent of the distance. Yeah. And fun. You know, you fast forward to today, whereas, you know, flight attendants now, even there is no, you start off just flying domestic, you're flying internationally. And it wasn't like that some 20 plus years ago.
Wow. And 20 plus years ago, I mean, becoming a flight attendant was a big thing.
It was a big deal. Yeah, we were stewardesses.
Yeah.
It was, yes.
It was
it was a big deal. It was definitely a big deal walking through the airport with your uniform and the way people looked at you. It was just definitely a big deal at the time.
you end up working with the ophthalmologist at the ophthalmologist's office and formed really great friendships.
Yeah.
Then you decided to move.
Yeah.
To Miami, Florida.
Mm-hmm.
What happened?
So it was at the point where I'd been working at the doctor's office for several years. And I remember telling my husband, I was like, you know, I feel like if we don't get out of Brooklyn, we'll never leave. We'll be stuck here. And, you know, at the time we were looking to buy a house and we just couldn't afford it. You know, as a young couple, we just couldn't afford it. And at the time, he was making six figures working for New York City Transit. So, but we still couldn't afford to buy a house. And I said, you know, honestly, we need to consider. And he had family that lived in Florida. And they just kept telling us, come on now, it's better to raise your kids here. And you should come down. And I remember he's like, you know, well, if you can get a job, because I can work anywhere, but if you can get a job, then we can do it. So I said, okay. And I applied to Royal Caribbean from while I was in Brooklyn. And that's just who I am. I'm the kind of person that you can't tell me I can't get something done. That's going to make me make it happen. So I remember applying for Royal Caribbean from New York, and they said there was a waiting list. And I saw on their website that they were doing what's called open call, whereas you had to be there in Florida. So I bought a one-way plane ticket. And I was just like, I'm not coming back. But one-way plane ticket. I was staying at his cousin's house, and I sat out 3 days in a row, just waiting, and finally got an interview. And they were like, okay, well, you know, we liked you. Go on the website. It's like, oh, I don't have to. I already applied. So, and that's how I ended up working at Royal Caribbean Cruise Line. And it was actually a great experience. I worked under their Celebrity Cruise Line. So that's their more high-end cruising. And I had certain clients that I was in charge of booking and creating their great vacations. And it was a great experience because it taught me a lot about customer service. It taught me a lot about patience, because especially people with a lot of money, when they want a vacation, they want it fast now. And sometimes they're not the most polite people when they want something. And it taught me patience, and it taught me how to just navigate, you know, and help people, even when they don't know what they really want. So it was a great experience for me.
You know, I'm listening to you and I'm thinking about how prepared you were for venturing into life coaching, which we'll talk about later on. Yeah. One of these experiences kind of sort of prepared you.
Definitely.
For your life coaching certification.
I would definitely.
So you land in Miami and you are working with Royal Caribbean Cruise Line, and you were there for a few years before you Atlanta, Georgia. What happened?
So I actually, I had gotten into a car accident. A lady just literally T-boned me, totaled my car, and ended up having my son prematurely. And so I was out on disability for some time, but I just knew that I didn't know if I wanted to go back. We were struggling in the sense with him being born prematurely and just really needing more around the clock care than anyone else could do in terms of a daycare and that kind of stuff. And once again, when it comes to career paths, it's another wonky, as I like to say, thing that happened. My cousin was getting married and came to Atlanta for her wedding and met her boss at the time, and was telling her boss, I said, you know, my cousin worked at the CDC, and I was telling her boss, I said, you know, I've always wanted to work at the CDC since I was in high school. And she's like, really? She's like, yeah. She's like, well, you know, if you ever are in the Atlanta area, you know, let me know. I can definitely get you a job. It'll be as a contractor, so it's an apprentice job, but you know, it's a foot in the door. And I was like, really? And I became obsessed and consumed with it. So I went back. That happened in February, right? So it happened in February. Went back to Miami. Told my husband, and he's like, okay. I was like, I said, I think I'm going to really pursue this. And I sent her my resume. And by April, 2 months later, I was living in Atlanta and I was working at the CDC. So it was like that fast.
Talking about dreams coming true.
It was that fast. It was that fast. And I'll tell you, it's my life experiences that, you know, anytime I am talking to someone or even if I'm coaching someone, I always tell people this is like kind of like my saying that drives me. I've learned over my experiences in life that society has conditioned us to chase our dreams. They tell you, you have a dream, you should chase it. But they never prepare us or teach us how to actually catch up to the dream sometimes. So we sometimes find ourselves constantly chasing after something. And based on how my life has unfolded, I have literally eliminated chasing my dreams from my vocabulary. I'm now a dream snatcher, and I work towards getting my dreams, not running behind it and never catching it. And I think it's from all those experiences is what led me to have that outlook.
You know, I hear you, and I'm thinking of so many different proverbs, and one that is used a lot, don't block your blessings, because sometimes the opportunities are here in front of us. But because we want something else, we don't see those opportunities and block them. And, you know, it's important that we are present. That's what I'm hearing from you.
Yeah, exactly.
It's important that we are present.
Exactly.
So that we can receive what's there for us and not go chasing what we think we should go for.
Exactly. Yeah. And to me, that is really important. And I think, you know, there's nothing wrong with dreaming. There's nothing, I'll be the first to tell you your dream, but you have to at some point recognize that a dream is kind of here, but you're not putting it to pen and paper. If you're not actually coming up with a plan to execute it, then that it'll continue to be a dream that you're chasing. You'll never actually be able to grab it in the moment.
Yep, yep. Love it, love it, love it. Let's take another peek of you.
I'm loving this part.
So, Nick, for the past 14 years, oh, by the way, for those of you who've joined us late, I'm sitting here with Onika Blaise, who's everything, an entrepreneur, community servant, pageant queen, pageant executive, public health advisor, you name it, she's doing it. So for the past 14 years plus, you've been working with Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. The first position that you had was a contracted one, like you mentioned, right? Yeah, that was a funny story, by the way. And you were a program analyst there. And again, your stars aligned. You were in a place where, you know, you voiced what your desires were, and it got lined up for you.
Yeah, definitely.
And you got your contracted position at CDC. How was doing this position, considering the newness of it? Because everything that you've said that you've done in the past is nothing like program analyst to me. Nothing about program analysis. So tell me, how did you make this work? Aside from training.
No, it was very, very different. But I learned very quickly that there was a culture at the agency, and that culture could either make your career or leave your career stagnant. And I quickly realized that the people that I needed to be exposed to were some of the older people that worked for the agency. So I just made alliances and friendships and networked with the people who no one speaks to, you know, the people who they have the historical knowledge of the agency. And I just got information and I just knew that this position was temporary, because with a contracting role, Georgia is an at-will work state, meaning that you can show up today and they can tell you, you know what, we decided we just don't like how your hair looks, so we're sending you home and we don't want you to come back, that kind of stuff. So I knew that I had to get a permanent position. So I just started taking a lot of training. Every opportunity I had, I enrolled, and CDC gives you these trainings for free. You know, the only thing is, if you're a contractor, you don't get first priority. The first priority goes to the full-time employees, and then whatever seats are left over, contractors will get them. So I just applied for a whole bunch, because I just knew that some of them I would get bounced out of and some I would get. And I just did training after training after training to perfect my role as a program analyst.
Now, obviously, those trainings counted for something.
Yes.
Because it shows that you're not only doing the work, but you're also learning the work the way CDC wants you to.
Definitely.
So after a year, I guess the contract expired, maybe. Mm-hmm. And you're looking at bigger and better things now, because you want a permanent full-time position.
Yeah.
How did you move into that full-time position of the management and program analyst? How did you move from being contracted?
So just applying. So I applied all the time and I would just get rejected. You know, you wouldn't, veterans would block me. And once again, I just think, you know, I'm a firm believer in what God has written for you. It's already written. He just lets you live through that moment, because every position I applied for, I got blocked because a veteran had blocked me, because veterans got preference. And I remember talking to one of my coworkers who was also a contractor, and I remember telling her, hey, there's this other position they're posting. I'm gonna apply. You should apply for it too. And she's like, no, you know what? I'm so tired of applying. The veterans keep blocking. And I applied for the position, and not one veteran was on that certificate. And my boss at the time, she was like, you know, technically I can pull you and hire you now that you made the certificate, but I don't have a vacancy. And so I was like, oh, you know, the time I actually make it, now I have no vacancy. And another supervisor, I reached out to her to see if she can pull me off of the cert, because, you know, you make it, but you have to have an actual job lined up. And she was like, no, you know what, you know, I'm going to go with someone else, you know, and I was like, oh, okay. So went back to my boss and I said, hey, I'm going to ask this other group, because I know they need someone. And that group was in direct competition with my group. And my boss was like, oh, okay. And next thing you know, I got a call from HR saying, hey, you've been picked up. And it was my boss that picked me up. So I thought it would have been the other group, but it was my boss that actually created a spot for me. And I was able to work with her for a few more years before moving on.
So we're talking about this program analyst position thingy, like if everybody knows what it is. What do you do? I mean, briefly, what do you do now as a management and program analyst? What are some of the functions of
So
your
as a
job?
management and program analyst, I did a lot of requisitions. We have a system called ICE, and that's where the contracts go into that system, and I was the person processing those contracts and basically giving them to the program, to several programs within the agency. And then they took those contracts and they awarded them. So I was the person that was triaging that before it got to the awarding stage.
Okay, so your job has a lot to do with vetting
Yes.
before.
Yes. It was a lot of vetting. So a lot of knowledge with contracts, and how programs function, because if you don't know how the programs function, you wouldn't be able to know which contract should be awarded or not.
Now, in terms of awarding contracts. Do you have a say in that, or once you vet it and you just disperse
Right.
to that's it?
So I have absolutely, at the time in that particular role, I had absolutely no autonomy, no say, no, I just, it looks good. This is what it is. Just, and here you go.
Okay.
When I was a program analyst, I had absolutely no say, but I learned budgets, which prepared me for
What you're doing now.
my public
All
health.
right, so let's talk about that. Now you're a public health advisor.
Yes, well,
You have a
I,
brand.
right. So I, so I'm actually now I've received a promotion, so now I'm a strategic workforce advisor now. But at the time before, I was a public health advisor, and that role was whereas I had more of a say. So I had say I was assigned to several states within the United States and territories. And every year we award a certain amount of money to the state so that they can conduct public health work. Like right now we're in COVID. So certain states need funding in order to be able to do testing, vaccines, just to do all the work public health entails. And the states that I was assigned as their public health advisor slash project officer, I recommended the funds. I had to go out to those states. I had to tour their public health facilities. They had to show me their budget. They had to show me every single line item. And when I would go to these states, it would sometimes span days because it's a large budget. And I recommended, no, you can't have the money for this, or you need to reallocate your money. If not, we're going to cut your funding. So I had more of a say so at that time.
Now with what you're doing, how is that shift dealing with strategies now because you're a
So
strategic.
it's less of the public health piece in terms of going to the states and the budget side. Now it is the development of people. So my role now is looking at the agency, looking at our critical staff, looking at whether or not we have the right people in the right roles, whether or not they're trained, or they just don't like what they do anymore. But it's more focused on the strategic side, and it has a lot to do with still doing re reading tons of data, because the data is what tells me how the workforce is driven. So it's in a different role now, but definitely still all roads leading to where I need to be.
So I'm still smiling. I'm still smiling, Nick, because I'm thinking, we're talking strategies now. You're a strategist and life coaching strategist, kind of. So we're getting there. We will get there. Now, I know you said you've graduated from being the public health advisor, now more focused on strategizing. In your new position, your current position, how are you working with COVID-related issues? I have to ask you.
No, definitely. So I'll tell you, so although I literally this it's been not even a full year that I have was promoted in this strategic role, And when COVID hit, I had only been doing it for a few months, and it became an all hands on deck. Whereas, you know, every single person had to shift to work on something COVID related, regardless of what your role was. And for 6 months, I was working as a staffing chief, staffing the COVID response. So we have several what's called quarantine stations where we have different epidemiologists that we're assigning. So I was in charge of an entire team that ensured that people were where they need to be. I was also working on what's called the runway to recovery, which is the airlines. We worked on maritime, which is the cruising industry. We worked in the back to school. So literally it was an all hands on deck approach. So I got a little bit of a glance into the more the epidemiologist side from way back when that I wanted to venture in. And but it was a really, really great experience because I got a chance to really see a different side of what COVID is doing, but not just how it's impacting the people that are being affected by it, but I got to see how our agency worked so hard to ensure that the American people were safe. And I got to see it from a totally different lens, not from the office that I currently sit in, but sitting in that role as that staffing chief. So it definitely gave me a renewed love and passion for the agency that I work for.
So sounds as though somebody's going to retire at that agency.
That's definitely the plan. You know, I always tell people, unless my coaching business is something that I'm passionate about, unless it takes me in different direction, I love working for CDC. I love the agency. And I love the fact that we are a public health agency, but we care about the people. So it's like Black Lives Matter happened and continues to happen throughout our country. This agency, a public health agency full of scientists, said, wait a second. We need to create a group to make sure that our staff, Black, white, Asian, Hispanic, that their mental health is improved. And they created programs to give people an opportunity to talk about how they're feeling with racial injustice right now in our country. And those programs are still going on right now. So definitely, if anyone's looking for a job, I would definitely say come to CC. we're a great organization.
Nice. I am so happy to hear that you're enjoying it, you know, yeah. Because then it doesn't feel like work anymore.
It doesn't. It really doesn't.
It's your passion that you're fulfilling. And it's funny that coming out of high school, you wanted to become an epidemiologist. And then what do you know? You'll land right in the spot where you're surrounded by them and you're feeling like one of them and working along with them and doing some of it. So really big congrats. Big congrats. Let's take another peek. How about that?
Sure.
Now, for those of you who are joining us now, or joined us after we started, I'm sitting with Nick Blaze. Emphasis on Nick. And one of the things she is an entrepreneur. And we just saw some photos of your businesses. And I so admire you for this. I am so beyond excitement for you. Why? It's not just beauty. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's the beauty with the brains. Let's put that out there. You know, let's put that out there. And we'll talk about the beauty in a couple of minutes or so. But what we've been talking about since we started is your accomplishment, your accomplishments along the way. And I have to confess, when I met little Anika, you know, 25 years ago, whenever, I know she was a go-getter because she won the pageant that I was involved in, the Miss Ghana USA pageant. I see Sybil Chester is on. Let me say hi to Sybil. Lerna Welchman-Deblet was one of the members of the pageant committee. I'm going down memory lane here now. Ozzie Kendall, Dennis Nelson, Christine Blackmore Williams. Oh my Walter, God, they're Walter. Boring. Say that again.
Walter
Green, and Roger Gary. Oh my gosh, wow, man. And we formed some lasting friendships. And now we fast forward, Anika, you know, you went to school, you did your thing, bachelor degree in psychology wasn't enough. Mm-hmm. You know, how about a master degree in social and behavioral sciences? And then you land your dream job. And then you, in the middle of all of this, hey, you know what? I need my own. And here we are in 2008. You became an entrepreneur. You and your mom, Wendy Williams, started the company Nick B. And we just saw some snippets here. Nick B Cosmetics. And this is a company that's based in Atlanta, Georgia, right? What pushed you to get into cosmetics? Why not crowns? You know, why not jewelry? What pushed you to cosmetics?
It was, honestly speaking, it was me spending a lot of money and never finding the right product that was right for me personally. I had to buy one foundation from one company, another foundation from another company, mix it together to get the right shade that works for me. And it's just, you know, I'm like, there has to be a better way. So my mom told me, she's like, you know, there's a lot of companies out there that companies use that, you know, we should do some research. And in just doing some research, realizing that there are several different companies out there that you can partner with and you can create your own brands. But the beauty about it is it takes time, because we went through several different companies before I found the formulas that I felt is a one-stop shop. You know, versus I didn't want any woman to have to mix anything. I wanted her to be able to come to Nick B and say, you know what? I may have some red undertones in some areas. I may have some yellow undertones in some areas. And Nick B has a foundation that I can get just for me. And that's where it got started.
I hope when we get off, I will have to stop.
Yes, I have to
say that. Yes.
Your package for having me today.
I want to stop mixing. So
yes, no.
I'm one of the mixers, and I know there are quite a few other friends who mix too. So I have to turn them on to Nick B.
Yes. Definitely.
Now, what's aside from the fact that Nick B caters to a diverse, diverse groups of women, what would you say is the standalone for Nick B in comparison to other products?
I think, you know, there are great products out in the market, but one of the things is, you know, we have a really, really great skincare line. And our skincare really treats your face, because you should be beautiful or feel beautiful whether you have makeup on or whether you don't have makeup on. And, you know, my model for Nick B was based actually on the Miss Guyana USA pageant.
Oh, yeah?
Our opening number was "I'm Every Woman."
Oh, I remember that. I was thinking
by Whitney Houston, and I wanted to have a company that can be our motto. Whereas this is for every single woman, regardless of what your skin looks like, regardless of how you view yourself, and we have since evolved because Now we have actually changed our tagline, and our new tagline as of 2 years ago is beauty by perception, not definition. Because a lot of companies out there sometimes will show beauty by what society tells us it looks like. So they define beauty in a particular way. So I'm telling you, beauty is all about your perception. It's in the eye of the beholder, what you perceive it to be. So that's what kind of sets us apart. But just making sure that we're treating the skin, not just masking and covering it up with makeup. We're actually treating your skin first.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, I just want to go back to the pageant again. I had a flashback. It's so funny, as I was preparing to speak with you, I was thinking, I can't remember, but I believe that Anika was in the pageant when we did the opening number, I'm Every Woman. Do you remember what professional person you were?
Because yes, I was military.
You were the military.
I was in the military, ironically, how all things lead to where you are. But I was a government employee. I had the military hat on, the hat and the military jacket, and I was marching.
Yeah. So that you all know what we're talking about, and we're not being rude by having an A and B conversation and saying you see yourselves out. It's not that at all. Back in the day when Anika was a delegate in the Miss Gana New York or USA pageant, I can't remember what we were calling it back then, I was the choreographer. And I did the choreography for the opening dance number, some of the, you know, the pieces that they did, how they did the patterns on stage and all of that. I did some work with that too. And the opening piece was done, the opening dance piece was done to Whitney Houston's I'm Every Woman. And then at the end, when there's that chorus that keeps saying, I'm every woman, each contestant kind of converted into a professional woman, whether it was a lawyer, whether it's a nurse, whether it was a doctor. So she's saying that she was a military person, you know. So those were lovely days though.
That's when pageantry was, you know, very different and just redefining, I think, you know. That pageant system was way ahead of their time. You guys had us doing, and the way you guys taught us about sponsorship and the importance of fundraising and sponsorship, it was way ahead of the time, because now that's what drives pageantry right now.
Well, we'll come back and talk about pageantry, but hail up to Miss Negla Helena Brandon, who is really a trailblazer when it comes to pageants and holding the women taking part in up in dignity, really. That's a good job of that. So what is the difference between, and here I may sound ignorant, let me preface it this way. What is the difference between cosmetics and beauty products, if there is a difference?
I think it's once again that perception piece, because when you think of, you know, cosmetics, people tend to just assume cosmetics means the makeup, like the color, the foundation, the eyeshadow. And then when you think of beauty products can be hair products, because that makes you beautiful, makes your hair beautiful. It can be certain concealers or a certain moisturizer. So it just all depends on how you view it. So I like to say beauty products, because it encompasses everything that makes a woman feel beautiful.
Okay, good, thank you. In talking about business, you're also the co-owner of Inspire Gravity Consulting. And this is a company that deals with fitness and pageant competitions, life coaching, and transportation. Yes. Tell us.
So Inspire Gravity, the name Inspire Gravity was actually my daughter, my soon to be 23-year-old daughter. She came up with this name, but it was for something else. And as I started to kind of doing life coaching, what I would say ad hoc, where you're just kind of doing it, you know, to help people, you're just known as the person that if you need advice, let's go to Nick. She can give me advice. She can help me. And as I started to realize that this was something that I needed to be keeping track of, I needed to start to make it more tangible and decide to start the company. And in thinking of a name, I said to my daughter, I said, can I take your name inspired graph? I said, because I feel like, you know, life coaching should make you the kind of person that people are inspired enough to want to gravitate towards. And she's like, yeah, I'm not using it. Go ahead. And that's how the name got started. And it started out as just that, more of a consulting company helping people, you know, navigate through life. And based on my pageant background, at the time, the Miss Universe Guyana organization reached out to me to help them get a young lady ready for Miss Universe. And that whole few months getting her ready, flying her out to Georgia, having her meet with different people and stuff, I realized that I needed to, you know, also make sure that I am separating the two, but they both have a place. And I started coaching young ladies to get ready for pageants, and, you know, from international pageants to local state pageants, but still doing the consulting piece. And then, you know, my husband does logistical transportation, and I'm like, okay, I don't need this to be all separate. There's a place for us to kind of have an umbrella, because at the end of the day, what Inspire Gravity does is it connects people, places, and things. Mm-hmm. So we were able to have all those different components under one umbrella company.
Yeah, I just might be a delegate, you know, in an upcoming pageant who needs some fitness and coaching, yes. And I might be moving to a different location, and I might need the trucking, the trucking services, so I can get everything from Inspire Gravity.
You can get everything. You can definitely get everything under this umbrella. People are multifaceted, and your needs are different, and I want to be able to provide what people need in different phases of their life.
Let me take a moment to say, did I say I'm proud of you?
Yeah.
sending it. So proud of you. And, you know, one of the things that I like about this program is not only that I get to learn, but I know viewership also gets an opportunity to learn things, to hear things differently from a different perspective. Because sometimes we know each other, but we don't know each other. And this conversation really sheds a different light on you as an individual who is really a brilliant example of how entrepreneurship can happen while you pursue your dream. You wanted to be an epidemiologist when you were getting out of high school. What are the odds that you landed your job, your dream job at CDC? Let's look at more of you. On that note, let's take another peek, Annika, aka Nick.
Guys found great pictures.
So for those of you who joined us after we started, I'm sitting with Annika Blaze, also fondly called Nick, who is a public health advisor turned strategist for CDC, life coach, certified to be exact, entrepreneur, community servant, beauty queen, pageant executive. we're getting into that area of her life now. We're talking about life coaching and her beauty queening and her pageant executing, you know, all. Yeah, I'm making words up, please. I'm making words up so you know. So, Nick, you are a certified life coach. How would you explain who is a certified life coach to folks who do not know what this is?
Well, the first thing I tell people is I am not a doctor. I am not a therapist. If you need a prescription that needs to be written, that will not be something that a life coach can do. You know, some of the myths is that a life coach is here to tell you all the answers and to tell you, you know, what to do. But really, a life coach is someone who's here to actually coach you through life. You know, you as the individual, you have all the answers. We're just here to help you navigate and to help you find those answers and to help you be able to formalize what it is you want out of life. It's almost like having a person that can hear your thoughts, that you can share your heart's desires with, and you can literally say, I don't know what I'm doing today. You know, I need some help. I need some guidance. That's what it's all about. But, you know, I think when you are more strategic in your life coaching, you're actually able to give people some tangible tools that they can actually use to assist them through life. So I do a lot of different parts of life coaching that some people may not do. I've incorporated a lot of different things to kind of make myself different.
So I'll ask you about that just now, but I was thinking this, right? Mm-hmm. In another life, I can, or in another day, I should say, mm-hmm. I could become a therapist, right? Because my bachelor and master degrees are in social work, mm-hmm. and I've done extensive clinical work for over 20 years. And there is this myth that because you're a social worker, you got it together. Mm-hmm. You know how to deal with life issues and, you know, you just know how to rock and roll. Wondering with what you just described as a life coach, if sometimes do you get that from some clients or some friends or a family that you're supposed to get it together, you're supposed to have it together, you're not supposed to have any problems.
Yes. Definitely. And that is a huge myth. You know, life coaches, therapists, doctors, they're all human. And we all have the same struggles everyone else has. I think because I have my own struggles, that it makes me have even more empathy because I know what you're going through. But I have two coaches that I actually work with that, you know, that I actually hire, I pay to life coach me because, you know, I may be an expert in certain areas, but I'm not an expert in some of the things that I'm struggling with. Yeah. So I need an expert to be able to help me. So the minute you are not coachable or you're someone who you can't reflect on where you need assistance, I think you need to either check your pulse to see if you've expired or soul searching to recognize that everyone needs to have someone to guide them.
Yeah. And then the other thing that needs to be thrown in there with what you're saying, Nick, is that most of our issues in life, they have to do with relationships. Yeah. And you're in a relationship with somebody else. So it doesn't necessarily mean that that person is the person with the problem. Mm-hmm. Or it doesn't necessarily mean that you are the person with the problem. Sometimes it's just that people outgrow each other. You know, they've been together for a mighty long time and things that were acceptable 25 years ago are not acceptable 25 years later and somebody's stuck in there and the rift comes up and there's so many different factors, but I just wanted to
Yeah, you become different people. Yeah, you become different people. And people have to allow themselves an opportunity to grow and be willing to acknowledge that the person that you have grown into may not still be the same person that is compatible with the people or person you were back when you
In essence, people grow up and sometimes grow apart. It's real like that, you know, and sometimes individuals hold on to relationships that they know. And why are we talking about that? We're supposed, anyways, it's part of life coaching. Now I remember. So one of the sidebar conversations we had was that you have some like sub, what I call like sub certifications with, you were telling me about the 360s and the real color and the Maya breaks. And I get the sense that these are specific assessment tools. Are they? Tell us about
them. So have you ever met someone that has the exact same birthday as you? And you're like, oh my gosh, we're born the same day. And as you got to know that person, you're like, we are so different. Like, and you'll say, maybe she was born on a different moon or something, because we're just different. So some of the certifications, like for instance, Real Colors. Real Colors is a temperament assessment and gives you an opportunity to assess your temperament, because your temperament influences how you respond to situations and different people and how you take on things. And that's very different from your personality. And like Myers-Briggs is another certification that I have, which is your personality. And then you also have people who study zodiacs, which is your horoscope. Different. It's all different. And these assessments really give me an opportunity when I'm working with a client. I'm able to give them a great outlook of who they are and why they end up responding the way they respond to certain things. But then also, it helps them reflect on recognizing other colors in other people. So if you can recognize the color of someone else's temperament, guess what? Because you can only control yourself, not the other person, you can be able to make adjustments and you can have less conflict in your life. So some of those certifications help me to take life coaching to a different level.
Yeah. I mean, I could see that. And one of the things that we learn along the way without going through coaching, I'm just saying we as lay people, is that as we begin to know each other, whether it's in an intimate relationship or domestic relationship with relatives, family, we know, okay, the voice went up, I'm checking out. You know, that kind of thing. It's like, ooh, you know, it's about to happen, you know. So
about to go down.
Yeah. We were able to like pull away. So in some ways, we have our own ways of learning how to avoid certain situations without even knowing that there is something called for it. There is an assessment called Real Colors that can, you know, really be done to help you learn more about yourself and how to really do business differently were you to recognize that you're in that space. Now, you also do work with individuals, couples, and corporations. How is it different in working with an individual and or couple than working with corporations when you're doing life coaching?
So they're very uniquely different. Yes, the common denominator is they're all people. So that's the commonality, but it's different because when I work with an individual, it's just literally that individual. And, you know, like I have their folder and their file and all that stuff. When you work with couples, because the couple sometimes knows that you're working with both of them, you as the life coach, you have to really recognize and separate that they are two separate clients. And you want to also make sure that you are not divulging, you know, because it's technically it's the same story, but from a different perspective. Yeah. So you can't really mix the two. You need to make sure that you're not less there together or having that open conversation. And then when you look at corporations, Corporation is a little bit more more in depth and can sometimes be more challenging because you're technically the client is the owner of that business, right? But then you're also working with their staff and they're technically a client too. So you have to really do a great job with making sure you are meeting the objective of the client that hired you, but you're not ignoring what those individual employees are feeling and what may need to be brought to the forefront in order to help them as well. So it's always a little bit more, I usually sometimes will bring a partner with me, depending on the size of the corporation that we're working with, but it definitely is different across across the board for sure.
So I want to switch a little bit and talk about, okay, so you're doing life coaching, you're doing the pageantry thing that we'll talk about, you're also doing Dorothy's House as a community servant, I would say. So in 2013, you founded Dorothy's House. What piqued your interest to start an institution such as Dorothy's House? Tell us about that.
My daughter, she definitely spearheaded this. This was definitely all her. Her just realizing that someone that she went to school with ended up losing both their parents and ended up in foster care. And she bumped into the person and realized the person had no place to live. And they're just kind of, and as she started to do more research, she's like, Mom, we got to do something. There's got to be something we can do to help, And she said she wanted to start this nonprofit organization. And I helped her start it. And it has since just taken on a life of its own and has just really, really grown. And it was based on the premise of my grandmother. She was everyone's mother. Like she'll take anyone in, come in, I'll feed you, I'll care for you, I'll help you. And that's why it's called Dorothy's House. But it is mostly about recognizing that young people get older and they grow up. And we have to at least try to be influential on the positive that those young people are gonna make in society. And in order to do that, we have to help them. We have to start at a certain foundation where we're helping them. And that's where Dorothy's House was born. And now it's mentoring. Now it's donating goods. It's just so different now. But most of the biggest piece is that mentoring piece with getting these mentors to help set these young people up for a more positive future.
So I have two questions for clarification. One, was Dorothy the name of your grandmother?
Yes.
Good. And the other piece is you're talking about the youths. And I believe that it's youths specifically who are in foster care.
Yes.
Right? And mm-hmm.
Are aging out.
Mm-hmm. And they're aging out. Now, you mentioned that there is mentoring. There is that mentor match mm-hmm. between youth and an executive. How are you setting this up? And what's the main responsibility of the mentor?
The biggest responsibility is your time commitment. So one of the first things that we do is we do a background check. We work with a company called Sterling Investigations, and they do background checks on all of our mentors. And the background checks, each background check is $40. And we actually make the mentor pay the $40 because we feel that if you are willing to pay money to get a background check, you're going to be committed as opposed to it's just something that you're just doing for fun. And our biggest thing is if someone feels that when I'm talking to you, you're looking at your watch or you're not really giving me that time, the connection piece is not going to be there. So making sure that when you agree to be a mentor with us, that you are agreeing that you have the time commitment that's needed, but you also have the interest and the drive and the desire, because sometimes your mentee, if you don't reach out to them, you'll never hear from them. So you have to take that initiative. So just being passionate and having that commitment as a mentor is the biggest thing that we require of our mentors.
Now, does gender matter when mentoring happens?
It does not. We do have part of the mentoring matching program, we do allow you to give preference. So as a mentor, you can select if you prefer to mentor someone of the same gender. So if you're a male, you want to mentor a male. And as well as the mentee gets to select if they want a mentor that's the same exact gender as well. But it's totally up to that person. And then we match according to your specification. We also will match the mentee from the mentee standpoint. We match you based on your career path. So if you're saying to me, you know what, I want to be an accountant. So guess what? I'm not going to match you with a basketball coach. I'm probably going to match you with someone who's in banking or someone who does financial planning or an accountant. That's so it's based on some of those parameters that we match people.
Definitely. I was going to ask that too. So part of the establishment has to do with working with, I would say, lightly funders, because if a company is giving whatever they're giving, whether it's a cash or kind, they're funding. And you've gotten support from companies such as Bank of America, Aldi's, Arena Dental, Coca-Cola, Southern Plastic Surgery, Caribbean Shipping. How did these relationships develop?
So it you know, a lot of these relationships, it's funny because some of these companies, pageantry is what actually connected me to a lot of these the people, because I've either coached their daughters, I've judged their daughters in a pageant, but pageantry has really connected these dots in these relationships. And they've been year-long relationships. I mean, Caribbean Shipping, for example, you know, I can call them at any time. They're also, you know, a Guyanese-owned company, and I can literally call them at any time, and they will not just provide monetary support, but just be there to support us. And it's all about it goes back to relationship building. These are all, there's not one company that you've named that I can say, I don't know who my point of contact is. I don't really know the person. They just send a check. No, it's literally someone that I actually know and I have developed a relationship with. And that's why they want to continue to be invested in supporting us.
Yeah. You know, you mentioned Caribbean Shipping. And I want to also take pause and really commend you and your daughter for the work that you're doing with Doherty's House, because the work doesn't stop here in the United States. You also do work internationally. That's with right. With countries like Trinidad and Guyana, where you're sending non-perishable goods to serve the youths in Canarsh, in Trinidad, and in Georgetown, Guyana. So I wanted to take pause and commend you and your daughter for the absolute, absolute much needed work that you're doing there, especially when it comes to foster children, because that's a whole population that specialized knowledge is needed for, with which to address their issues appropriately. So thanks for that work. Let's take another peek and come back. For those of you who've joined us late, I'm Rose October, sitting with Nick Blaze, consultant, entrepreneur, pageant queen, pageant executive, public health advisor turned strategist at CDC, Should I go on? A balance, a total balance of beauty in brains. So we just saw your passion. pretty much. So, I mean, I exaggerated, right? But it's one of your passions, your involvement in pageantry. You've been in the pageant business for over 20 years, and you were in pageants as far back as in elementary school. Yeah. I remember you said that, then you went into Al Jackson Teens, Talented Teens, right? Mm-hmm. And then it was the Miss Ghana New York pageant. I saw Donna John turn Igato with her fancy name, who was in the chat earlier. Hey, Donna, shout out to you. And then the Miss Caribbean International pageant. And guess what? Most of them you won, with the exception of one.
Yeah.
Most of them. So when we talk about, and I'm talking to viewership here, when we talk about a queen, we are talking with a queen here. You know, a real, as we would say in Guyana or in the Caribbean, a real, real queen. And one of the pieces that I like, which is a nice reflection, is that when you did the Al Jackson Talented Teens, where you brought fourth place, it was over 100 delegates. So you might as well have won it. Right. You know, I mean, that's awesome. So what was your most memorable of those earlier pageants before you took your hiatus?
I would definitely say meeting friends. I mean, I have lifelong friends that I have known through pageantry. You know, I have friends who are now some of my dearest friends. They've been in my wedding. You know, they do my taxes. Like, it's just, you know, we just have a great, great relationship. But one thing I will say that I've learned early on in pageantry that's still very relevant now is that know what you want at the end before you begin. Because when you're younger, you want the crown, you know, you want to win, you want to win, you want to win. And then as you get older, you realize that the crown is just the trinket, you know, it's just the thing. So definitely I would say I've learned to know what I want after the crown. And I learned that very early on, but even before I did Miss Guyana, I knew, I learned that what I wanted. You know, Al Jackson was a, it was a talented, yes, you had modeling, but it was about talent, the best dancer, singer. Those are, that's what they were looking for. So I knew at the time, I was like, I want to be a dancer. So I have to win this pageant so I can be seen by a talent agency to be a dancer. So definitely knowing what you want before you even compete.
So let me share this with you. I don't know, you probably haven't heard it, but in reflecting on Miss Guyana New York pageant, like you mentioned just now, we knew that you wanted it because we would huddle and talk about the young ladies in the pageant. You gotta watch that one. You gotta watch that one, Nika. You gotta watch her, you know? And I know Sybil Chester is probably chuckling to herself, and so is Brenda. And maybe even Donna, but we would huddle and say, this one looks hot today. She got to tussle with that one. It's going to be a hard one. But I remember the night of that pageant, how charged it was at Brooklyn College.
Yes.
It was Brooklyn College, I remember. That was a wild night. And you really had a lot of competition in that pageant.
It was tight. I tell everyone every day, I was like, it was a tight competition. Because I can tell you, just being in it, there were several people that I'm like, she couldn't win. Like, it was like that. And it was because I knew that, I think that my reaction when I won was generally I was shocked when I was the last, one of the last two standing. The tears came because I was like, oh my God, I'm getting first runner up. This is amazing. This is so good. You know, I mean, because it was that tight of a competition. You know, there were so many women that were just incredible that it was that tight.
Yeah. So then you took an 18-year hiatus after you did the Miss Caribbean International pageant.
Yeah.
You took 18 years off, became a wife and mother, just like that, you know, 18 years and things happen. You became a wife and mother. And by the way, I heard the talent of pageantry is in the family. We saw your daughters, right?
Oh, the girls, yeah.
We saw them strutting their stuff just so in a few pictures. So after the break, you entered the Mrs. Georgia.
Yeah.
What's going on with you then?
My daughter signed me up, my oldest daughter. she said, Mom, did you know there's a pageant for misses, people who are married? I was like, oh, really? There is? She's like, yeah. She's like, yeah, you're going to get an email. You know, I sent them an email and I sent your picture. And I got an email saying, hey, you know, thank you so much for applying. You know, we I was like, it was one of those things that when I competed that in 2015, when she signed me up, it was maybe 6 weeks before the competition.
Yeah.
So I literally had a dress that I kind of had, did my own hair and makeup, didn't work out. And I'm thinking, we're all married. We've all had children.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, you know. And once I entered, I got a rude awakening. I was like, wow, these women are amazing. Their bodies look great. this is going to be tough. This is going to be really, really tough. And I wish that first year, I said to myself, I wish I was better prepared, because I just kind of, she applied for me. I went with the flow and wasn't as prepared as I would have liked to be prepared.
But guess what? You were the second runner up.
I was shocked. I was shocked, and that's when I said, you know, if I could be less prepared and get second runner up, I said, if I prepared, I can come back and win this thing next year. I cannot see.
Dead.
And that's what happened. Yeah.
That's what happened. Now, you're coming with a lot of baggage, good baggage, about pageantry. You would be considered a veteran now because you've been there, done that, right? And you're going back a second time for the Mrs. Georgia pageant. Second year in concession. What are you going in with now that tells you that the crown is mine?
So this time around, I knew not necessarily the players, because contestants change, but I knew the rules of the game. And by knowing the rules of the game, I knew that in order to win, I said to myself, I need to be the best woman in swimsuit. I need to be the best woman in evening gown. I need to be the best in interview. And if I win those areas, then I know I would win the competition. So I was more prepared this time around, and I put the work in. I put the work in to make sure that whether the crown was given to me, I knew that I would leave the stage not feeling like, oh, I wish I had gotten in shape. I would leave knowing that I did the best I could do. So I was better prepared and better equipped.
Now, winning that pageant pushed you forward.
Yes.
You were going forward to represent Georgia at the Mrs. USA.
The Mrs. America.
Mrs. America. Mrs. America. I'm all excited. Tell us about that.
Now, that was a great experience because it was held in Las Vegas, and we were there for an entire week of just getting ready, preparing, rehearsals, and all that stuff. And it was a great opportunity. And the funny thing about it is, when I went to Mrs. America, I went to Mrs. America saying to myself, I don't need to win the pageant. It's like, I don't really care whether I win or not, but I need to expand my cosmetics business. So my goal was to literally take Nick B and open it up to the pageant community so that people can see that, hey, if I'm competing in a pageant, I can use that makeup because that beauty queen used it. So my goal was to utilize the Mrs. America organization as a way to network and grow my business. And that's what I did.
So you placed fifth?
Yeah.
Of 52 women.
Yeah.
Oh man, can we give her a round of applause, please?
Amazing, amazing women who are also some of my dearest friends to this day. Like my roommate in Vegas, still a great friend. So definitely it was a really, really wonderful experience.
You know, before we get off the topic, which we will in a minute, I don't want to take it for granted that people know that viewership, I don't mean to be disrespectful of viewership by saying people, that viewership knows what Mrs. America is about or Mrs. Georgia is about. Could you quickly educate us?
Yes. Yeah, so every pageant has a particular age group that it caters to. And the Mrs. America organization is a pageant system that's geared towards married women. You can't be married and divorced or married and separate. You have to be a married woman. And it gives an opportunity to married women all around the United States to be able to represent their state. If you win Mrs. America, there is a Mrs. World pageant, just like the Miss World. There's a Mrs. World pageant that you can represent the USA abroad against all the different countries to be Mrs. World. But it is a pageant based for married women.
Now, let me ask you this technical question. Could a state not host the pageant and just select somebody to go and represent them at the Mrs. America, or the stipulation is that you must have won a pageant in your state?
In your state, yep. You must win your state, and that state has to hold a pageant, whether it's three contestants or 27 or 50, that state has to hold a competition for you to win that title to represent at Mrs. America.
Wow. So another title you hold is a fancy one, pageant executive. And I want to return to your expertise as a certified life coach and link that with your years and personal experience in pageants, really. And I wonder, how does the general experience unfold for you when working with clients seeking fitness and pageant services from Inspire Gravity Consulting? Everything together.
It definitely is, you know, because as I said, at the premise is Inspire Gravity is a company that's going to help you. And I'm called to service. So because of my call to service, it gives me an opportunity to actually hear people. You know, being able to sometimes look at a person's body language and know what they're feeling and just kind of, you know, pull it out of them. But with Inspire Gravity and pageantry and just even competition coaching, we are there to make you feel like a winner. That is the bottom line. Whether I can't guarantee, I do have a good winning track record. I will say that my clients do win. So I'm not going to, you know, not say that. But my goal is that you're going to feel like a winner, whether you get the crown or not, or you get the trophy or not, because I am making you feel like a winner from within. And that's what sets us apart. You know, it's about, you know, I once had someone who was a client of mine, and she started her own consulting company. And it was brought to my attention that the material that I would give her, she's now basically took out Inspire Gravity and put her name there. And the person's like, you should sue her. Like, this is terrible. And I said, you know, you can copy my words, but you can never replicate the way I make people feel. And that's what this is about, the way I make people feel.
So aside from the way that you make people feel, what is that I'm warning you guys out there now. I'm going into my Guyanese kind of Caribbean dialect. What is that that your company has, Inspire Gravity has, that other companies do not, that contributes to your winning track record? What is that that you have?
Preparation. We, like I said, my girls will tell you that it is not that I give them, hey, do this, do that, let me teach you how to walk. And no, it is hands-on. It is dedication, because I'm dedicated to you winning. And I like to win. So in order for us to win together, I have to make sure you're prepared. I'm aligning you with the right people. I am coaching you towards that victory. So it's all about that preparation. But the secret oomph, I believe, is my temperament assessment, assessing your temperament, so that, because you cannot fix something or perfect it if you don't face it and know what it is. And I think that temperament assessment, you have to be certified with Real Colors in order to do that. And I don't really know anyone else that is in this industry, to be quite honest.
I love it. You sneak you. I love it. What is the age of the youngest client you've worked with?
Five years old, yes. Five. My youngest client has been five, and my oldest client, and she will kill me if I say this, but she's 52 years old.
Okay. That's not old anymore.
What are you talking about? But you know, in pageantry, people never like you to tell people. But my oldest pageant client is 52.
Well, considering there is Mrs. America. Yeah. You will have older clients than 52. Now, what pageants are there for five-year-olds?
So even the system, the franchise that I'm a part of, so Laura Clark owns the Miss Earth USA pageant, which is under the higher Miss Earth organization. And I'm a franchisee owner of Alabama, Georgia, Florida, Tennessee. And we have what's called our teeny Miss division. And that starts at 5 years old. So with our system, you can be from as young as five all the way to 59 years old if you're a Mrs. So there are several systems out there, but we are one of the best and have been ranked nationally and internationally as one of the best systems out there.
Yeah. I can't believe we're almost out of time, but I have to ask you one more question about pageantry. And this is a ticklish one. When I tell my guests this is a ticklish one, it's because it has various views out there. Mm-hmm. What is your view on pageantry? And the reason I'm asking you that is because there are a lot of people who are naysayers, and there are a lot of people who are yaysayers. And I'm not going to try and say what some of them are saying, what the naysayers and yesayers are saying, because I don't want you to be influenced by what I've heard. But I want to hear, what is your position, aside from the fact that pageantry is a passion of yours? Let's put that out there. Bearing in mind that pageantry is a passion of yours, there may be some bias, and that's all right. But tell me, what are your thoughts about pageantry?
I think pageantry is a sport. It's, you know, it's no different than football, basketball, soccer. It is our sport. And, you know, in our sport, you're going to have passion, and passion can sometimes lead to seeing the best of what industry has to offer. And it can sometimes show an ugly side. When there's anything where people are competing, there's the good and the bad and the in-between, or the things in between, right? But my view on pageantry is that it is always evolving. You know, it's a walk in contradiction, because you see beauty and you sometimes think beauty is shallow, but you talk to a pageant girl, they're accomplished, they're lawyers, they're doctors, they're people who are really making an impact in society. So I would definitely say it's like anything else, good, bad, and in between, but it is definitely our sport and we play it well.
You know, I love your response because I have so many thoughts firing off here in my head. You know, one of them is that there have been some kind of semantics where the word pageant has been removed from, you know, beauty pageants. It's just pageant. Then there are some who are against pageants who would say, oh, women shouldn't be exposing their bodies like that. Why they have to be exposing their bodies like that? So there is that that concern over there. Then there is a concern over there that why is it that they have to have a particular set of qualifications? Why is it that they have to have degrees? You know, that kind of a thing. It's such a mixed bag. And it really, I like what you said in terms of it being a sport, because being a sport can be so many different things also, because it doesn't mean that, like one of my friends would say, that there's no gray matter between your two ears. Yeah. You know, there's so much involved. And I think the more individuals become educated about pageantry, the better the world of pageantry will be and could be. And our boys, I did say boys, there are male pageants, boys and girls will not be discouraged because of ignorance. Ignorance meaning not knowing. So I'm glad to hear that you put it in that context, that it really is a sport. Now, how do you prepare for winning that sport? I love it. So as we come to a close, I would like to congratulate you, Nick, you know, for the inspirational work that you continue to do. You've done and you are doing, and you continue to do. You've been recognized for your exemplary service in public health, for your continued role in emergency preparedness. Kudos to you. You've also been honored by the governor's office and City Hall of Georgia with proclamations and citations for your dedicated work to children in the foster care system. We thank you. I would like to echo those recognitions and say big, huge thank you for making a difference in the lives that you touch, not just at work at CADC, because I know you're doing that, but in the other aspects of your life. Really, thank you for that. And most importantly, thank you for coming through on Arts, Culture, and Thing in Between. And
yeah, I had a great
chatting with me. So before we go, you get the last word in telling our viewers where could they learn more about you and your businesses.
Definitely for Inspire Gravity, we are at inspiregravity.com. Nick B Cosmetics is nickbcosmetics.com. And if you are interested in the Miss Earth USA organization, they may be a state where it has a state competition. You can go to missearthusa.com and you can apply or recommend someone. Definitely, I want to just simply say, you know, thank you for having me today. I think the arts is very important because it has shaped me since I was a child. And every memory has led me to where I am. And I definitely will encourage anyone to get out there and do something artistic today. Or if you are of talent, share your arts with someone else. But thank you so much for having me. I had a wonderful time today.
I did too. Thanks. So for more information on today's guest, you heard it from her, you know, check out her website and what we always do, Google it, yes. You know, Google it. And also you can check her Facebook page. And as I say, thanks to today's guest, Bonica Blaze, fondly called Nick, and to you, the viewers, for joining us today on Arts, Culture, and Thing in Between. I must acknowledge my very important individuals, Claire Goring, who does the flyer every week, Marcia Gordon, who's been working on the YouTube channel, Yashsuna Ryan for building the website. Please visit the website, roseoctober.com. And the YouTube channel is Arts, Culture, and Thing in Between. Dr. Raul Manzano, I saw you on earlier. I'm not sure if you're still around, but hi, Dr. Manzano. Thank you for painting the logo. The rose is hand-painted for the website. That rose is hand-painted by Dr. Raul Manzano, my colleague, my friend. Thank you. Raul De Silva, the technical engineer who was instrumental in jumpstarting this program in May of 2020. And he worked with us until, I think, the first week in December, after which Sammy Samuels, the young creative, took over. Sammy, thank you. These individuals have been special because they've unselfishly given up their time. You know, Claire, Marcia, Yash, Dr. Manzano, Raul, and Sammy. So I want to just big you guys up and thank you. And something that I've been overlooking for a long time, it just occurred to me, but I still need to address it, although it just occurred to me. Mm-hmm. I want to big up Ghana Cultural Association because this program is also streamed through Ghana Cultural Association's website. So I want to thank the Ghana Cultural Association of New York for allowing the program to be streamed through the website. To all of you who continue to support us by joining Arts, Culture, and Thing in Between on Sundays from 3 to 5, I thank you. I sincerely thank you. For those of you who will be watching the recording because time did not permit and prevented you from joining us live, thank you. So I encourage you to tell a friend, like the Facebook page, like and subscribe to the YouTube page, and please visit the website at roseoctober.com. I look forward to you joining me again next week, 3 to 5, as you tell a friend and bring a friend along. I'm your host, Rose October, wishing you safety, good health, and a productive week ahead. And most of all, I'm sending you love. Happy Valentine's Day. See you next time. Bye-bye, everybody.